starting in fact, isn't
it? Yeah, we're rolling. So project your theatre voice. Yeah.
Music.
hear it in the background.
Facebook Live. Facebook Live.
Yeah. Is it a lot of people?
explain what's happening.
So we're doing a check-in question right now. And the point of the check-in question is really to kind of break the ice, get people to know each other a little bit more, and also to just learn a little bit about each other so it's not so awkward, right? So once we're all in and we've shared the check-in, I'm going to call it a safe space, and then we're going to take it from there. So stay tuned.
That's me, that's the cameraman.
Two of you. Anybody else would like to share?
This is your opportunity. The more people know what you do, the more people can help you with your business and your passion. So, yes, I feel like you and Wanda had an interesting conversation. So I'm tempted to ask.
Lady!
You can start and then we'll finish it off.
So yes, we had a... I'm Dee.
Hi, Dee.
And I'm one of those people who left corporate 4 days ago.
Woo! Fresh out!
So very fresh
out. So this topic was like, it spoke to you. The fear of leaving. You were like, that's me. I'm in.
I'm like, geez, when I found that on Meetup, I was like, oh my God. Can I get there now? I think I was one of the first people in the door earlier
today. Oh, bless you. Okay.
But yes, wonderful to meet somebody who's inspired about developing people and being involved in putting on a program like this that gives us the opportunity to network and to grow within the sphere of entrepreneurship.
Nice. All right, nice to meet you, Dee. You're an interesting woman. Great.
Yes, hi, I'm Wande. So I met Dee, and Dee is business consulting. She said she just left corporate 4 days ago. So she's still trying to feel her way around what she needs to do. But she's also very much passionate about people. Yeah.
All right, so that was the check-in question. I'll probably circle back to purpose and passion. So I'm going to give a few house rules first before I get into who we are as Impact Hub and what the Hub Hustle is about and introducing the speakers for today. So first off, this is a safe space. So whatever is said here is safe. I do have to say though, we are live streaming, so safe but safe. Safe. But in that, it being a safe space, what I really am trying to say is we need to respect each other. So when one person is speaking, I would like to ask that only one voice be heard and we all pay attention to that one person, because it's not an easy thing sometimes to speak, right? So we can respect each other in that regard. Bathrooms are out the front, right? Out the door, onto the right, onto the left-hand side, okay? And towards the end, we are going to do a Q&A session. And when you stand up, I ask that you stand up, you say your name, and you say your purpose or your passion, right? And if it relates to a business, if you're an entrepreneur, I would encourage you to mention that aspect of your business. It's just great for the networking section afterwards, so people can be like, oh, we have similar interests, or, you know, I'd like to hear a little bit more. And that's really the real purpose of this gathering today, is for us to grow one way or another, okay? Okay, so that's pretty much the house rules. Tag us. You know, hashtag us, you know, with the topic. Hub Hustle, powered by Alan Gray, would be great to be seeing on social media as well. So that's my shameless plug for it. So, let me tell you a little bit about Impact Hub. So Impact Hub's Johannesburg is the only Impact Hub that is actually operating in South Africa. We are part of a global network with over 100 other Impact Hubs, right? And within the African continent, there is over 12 hubs. So we're pretty big, and what we really focus on is social entrepreneurship, because anything that has to do with impact is really where our heart is at. And as an organization, what we aim to do is really to be a lighthouse for entrepreneurs, a safe space. We try to create a sense of community, a sense of family, and a sense of belonging, because we understand that entrepreneurship is probably one of the scariest things that there is out there to do. It's an extreme sport. Irrespective of how knowledgeable you are, things can go wrong, and when they do go wrong, generally you left pulling baby on your own. So what we try to do is have events similar to this, like the Hub Hustle, in order to encourage and support entrepreneurs in Johannesburg, in South Africa, in Africa, globally. Okay. And we do this through our incubation/acceleration program called Launchpad, which will be opening later on this year, I've heard, possibly. Okay, so keep an eye out for that. That basically is a six-month program that allows us to incubate entrepreneurs in their ideation and startup phase. The second thing we do also is we provide co-working, which is really the sense of community. community that I'm talking about. That's the hardest deal. That's where a lot of our co-workers come home to and work. We also offer office space for SMEs. So we've got companies that have got 10, 5, 15 employees. So it's a really nice mix and a great learning space, no matter what phase you're at. And we also do events in the space, and there's more space at the back. So if you need a tour of the space, let me know and I'll show you around. Okay. And really, we encourage most entrepreneurs to join us. You know, whether it's virtual, whether you're in the space physically, it's really up to you, but we do encourage you to be part of the community. So, HUB Hustle. So this year's theme is called Coming Out the Entrepreneurial Closet, right? And the reason why we've gone with that is we've partnered with Alan Gray, which is a pretty amazing organization. I have mad respect for what they do and what they've done and the impact they've had in people's lives, especially in the entrepreneurial space. So the theme is Coming Out the Entrepreneurial Closet, and today's theme is the fear of becoming. Because a lot of us have a lot of reasons or barriers that we cannot overcome in order to go into entrepreneurship. And what we wanted to do is have an honest conversation with like-minded, young, innovative, young people who have overcome their fear of becoming an entrepreneur. And that's really what we're going to sit here today in the panel and unpack. But it's a whole series. It's a year-long series, and we would really love to see more of your faces. Bring your friends, bring your cousins, you know, bring everybody. And let's have robust conversations around this, honest, robust conversations, might I add, about what entrepreneurship is, because it really is the thing that's going to change the economy for us as a country, and it's the thing that's going to take us to the next level. So I'm going to stop blabbering, and I'm going to allow One Day to come through and tell us a little bit about Alan Gray and what it is that they do, and yeah.
We aim to foster an equitable and equitable society, an entrepreneurial society, which aims to literally drive entrepreneurship in this country. So that's literally what we're focusing on. So our drive as an organization is for us to see young people going out there and changing the world through entrepreneurship. Because we feel that the only way that you should change society is through entrepreneurship. That's how we change things. So individuals that go out there with innovation, with passion, change society. Thinking if you can go to the next slide. I just want to take you through who we are as the actual group of philanthropists under Mr. Alan Gray, because he's set up these philanthropic organizations, of which we are the Alan Gray Orbis Foundation, which underneath that sits the scholarship, the fellowship, and the association, which I am part of. Then the Alan Gray Entrepreneurship Challenge, but I'll take you through those as we move to the next slide. But also we have the endowment which has Funga Wande, which is a reading for me, so early childhood development, but focusing on reading. And then Jake Fairbox focusing on teachers, educating teachers to also be very much change makers and innovative and entrepreneurial teachers. And then we've got 10KJ is focusing on and creating jobs. So those are the different philanthropic organizations and the World Knowledge Olympiad. Move to the next slide. So just taking you through our value chain. So the Adam Gray Entrepreneurship Challenge, like I mentioned earlier. So that's focused on any learner to access entrepreneurship in a very gamified manner. So it's literally a game, a challenge that's played at schools, so young people can actually access entrepreneurship through a game. And they don't necessarily have to go through learning theory, but it's actually a live game that they can play around with. While they're playing that game, they're actually learning about entrepreneurship and engaging with entrepreneurial thinking. And then the scholarship, which is the beginning of our entrepreneurship and education term, we have a scholarship where young people can access, apply while they're in grade 6 to get to study, or we take them to study at good schools from grade 8 to grade 12. And whilst they're studying, they're also embedded in that program as an entrepreneurial development program. So whilst they're also studying, they learn entrepreneurial thinking, entrepreneurial mindset. And then we have a fellowship program, which is for our learners and students in tertiary. So you get to apply while you're in grade 12, and you get funded from first year to fourth year, your degree. But also whilst you're studying, it's also embedded in that as an entrepreneurial development program, personal education program, where you get to play around with entrepreneurial thinking with the hope that once you graduate, you will embark on an entrepreneurial journey, either through your own business or through being a change maker within an organization, coming in with innovative ways of changing things and how things are done within your organization. So that's the fellowship. And then once they graduate from that, they move into the association, which is where I'm at. I'm the community manager in the Allegrave Association of NBA fellows. So I, the community manager, literally foster engagement and come up with amazing platforms for them to engage with one another, collaborate, and find creative ways for them to start businesses together or to be able to advance in their own journeys as entrepreneurs. And then we have E-Squared, which is our impact funder, where these individuals can actually have an opportunity to pitch for funding if they've got an amazing business. And then literally that's the journey for them to become a higher and responsible entrepreneur.
If you can move to the next slide, I just want to show them.
So currently our alumni that's in the association, we have 510, that will be this year, 510 alumni. Those are individuals that have graduated from our program. And of that 510, 132 are embarking on an entrepreneurial journey. So it's either through a full-time startup or they've got a side hustle while they're working. So the full-time entrepreneurs are 66. And we have two fellow businesses, or rather businesses of our alumni that are valued at $1 billion. If you can move to the next slide. Those are just some of the businesses of our program participants. So you probably recognize some of the brands there, maybe from some of the businesses that you might have engaged with or come across. So as an organization, we very much focus on the entrepreneurial development learning side, so we believe that entrepreneurship can be taught, that there's actually a pathway that you can take in order to become a responsible entrepreneur. To the next slide. So if you go to the next slide, just want to take them through why we're embarking on this. So the reason why we also partnered with Impact Hub is because as an organization, we've embarked on some research around what it takes to become an entrepreneur. And we did a bit of a study and came up with 14 competencies of what we feel were common threads through 1,500 entrepreneurs that we interviewed. So those are the common threads that will somewhat be some of the themes that we'll be using for some of these talks. If you can go through. So those are the 14 competencies that we felt are required for an entrepreneur. So we could either say whether all of them, or if you want to focus on four, say opportunity assessment, growth mindset, leadership, and self efficiency are probably the ones that are quite core, but everything else would be quite relevant if you have it, like if you're building a team, to have individuals that kind of play in the different mindsets in order for you to become a successful entrepreneur. So that's some of the research that we've worked on. And it's South African individuals that we interview, so this ends up being very much South African great tech research that we've done, which is quite new as well, because a lot of the research tends to be outside of the country, not necessarily local. So that's quite eccentric to SA. So, and in terms of also as an organization, just to say that our where we play is very much in the early stage, pre-ideation, so to help individuals from the ideation phase to get them to businesses. And that's literally what we feel that this research can help individuals to be able to measure entrepreneurship, to be able to develop their own entrepreneurs or their own team. And also can help either as a tool for selection, either for your own team as you're building your team as a startup. And also at the same time, we feel that it's also great for personal mastery. So you can also be able to measure yourself against some of those competencies and look at which areas that you can potentially work on to develop your own self. And then also it is for like mentoring. So you could look at areas which you could be able to develop. But I think also at the same time, we've got this research on our website. So also if you want to speak to me afterwards, feel free to engage with me and we can talk through and I can tell you a bit more. But yeah, so we literally head over to Cynthia to take us through.
Citizenship and awareness, collaboration, communication, and coding. So our company takes care of five out of those six competencies, everything but coding, essentially. So I'll tell you more about the business throughout some of the discussions, but over the last 4 years, we've worked with over 3,500 learners from across South Africa, Zambia, China, the United States. We've worked with awesome organizations like APSA, Constitution Hill, Weber Wenzel, the NBA in America, and many others that I'm forgetting, and I hope you're not watching this live stream. So yeah, very, very fulfilling work. And our goal has always been to bring South African education and education across Africa into the 21st century. And that's the reason why I get up every morning. I'm also a proud uncle of two. I grew up in the south of Joburg, so if you're from the south, whatever, like, oh, okay, two people, we made it, right? They only let two people out of the south every year. So yeah, I grew up in the south, and wonderful family, and I'm honored to be here.
Miracle of learning is happening and people are engaging content very intimately. And how I came to be involved with Zoom is through debating. So I'm from KZN and I came to this. I left behind my life as a goatherd and started first year. And I joined the next debating union and it was there that I met Ongani as well as the rest of the Zoom team. And what was interesting was that a common thread through all of us was we recognized how the debating space and specifically these competencies that we've learned in that context had really, really prepared us as far as thriving in a range of environments. And the ability to just pass that on to learners, but moreover, the ability to ideate and do curriculum development, as well as the development of products that find innovative ways of teaching the skills, has been a really, really amazing process. It's an inspiring process, and it's something that makes me feel as though my talent and my potential is being utilized in a very impactful and meaningful way.
Hey everybody, can you hear me? Awesome. So my name is Daliso Ngoma. I'm the managing director of a company called African Technopreneurs. So to keep it short, we're mainly based in the virtual reality side of things. So if you talk about this or IR and all that other stuff, we're actually doing it. So the two guys at the back, they're actually involved in the hardware and also the software development. So what was actually mentioned, coding, that's one of the things that we're actually teaching. And yeah, I literally think that we are just in the space of having fun. I try as much as possible to have fun in the office, but that's the environment that we encourage. Even the whole name Technopreneurs was to encourage more guys in the coding space, actually even in the tech space, to even grow their businesses. So apart from that, my story starts where I came back to South Africa in 2017. I'd spent 6 years in Malaysia, decided to quit my job, didn't have any plans. They did try to offer me a 50% increase, so clearly they were underpaying me. So the mere fact is that I just decided to come back. Was intending to actually go abroad again, but I was like, might as well just take the chance of starting my own business. So from there, it started off with like web development, then slowly but surely progressed into playing around with 360 cameras, and then by whatever chance, jumped into virtual reality. So my software engineering was more focused towards mobile development. And with virtual reality, augmented reality, I'll probably explain all those terms later on, but it's the stuff of the future, and that just had an interest in my heart. And apart from that, is that I've also just gone into the space of hiring a few more people to really just grow the business. So we've just identified the gap where there was no hardware, and I think, again, when it comes to this new tech, you're always seeing it in like Europe, America, Asia. I was literally wanting to actually bring it here to South Africa. So that's literally my story, and yeah, so far, so good.
Thank you.
And we've also got a meetup every last Thursday for We Are VR. So all us geeks in the VR space, that's where you'll find us at the Keys Arch Miles Gallery. So yeah, awesome.
That was
okay.
So I'll use an anecdote using my own experiences. When in 2016, my best friend and I, who as Peter mentioned were competitive debaters, worked in this a shadow industry that exists in Johannesburg that a lot of people don't know about, where like private schools will hire university debaters to come and tutor their kids and teach them critical thinking skills and pay them decent money, right? And a lot of us in that space were willing to take up those jobs because it helped us pay our way through university, buy textbooks, and so on and so on. What we realized though is that giving them that skill, there's nothing wrong with the trade itself, but it further increased inequality in South Africa because private school kids who already are getting a better education and have better facilities are also being prepared for the 21st century in a way that kids in government schools simply are not being prepared. And so we started doing a small number of projects in the East Rand. And I remember for our first project, we were paid in diaries and mugs. That was it. And we were really excited and we were honored by the fact that someone was willing to pay us for our work using mugs and diaries. But then we invoiced them for 2,000 Rand after that, and we blew it all on pens for our diaries. But what my partner told me at the time was, and I found this incredibly wild when he first suggested it, that being, we need to turn this thing into a business. There's clearly space in the room in the education space for us to turn this innovative way of teaching into a fully fledged company. And next year, we need to be making 10,000 Rand a month each. I was like, what? We're in second year, dude. Like, that doesn't, no one makes 10 grand a month in third year. But he was the first person to really get me out of my comfort zone and start thinking about building a business. So at the time, I was in law school, and my goals were very, very simple. Finish law school, become a lawyer, and one day become like a Harvey Specter with a happy marriage and kids. I'm very, very risk-averse, and I'm an incredibly conservative person when it comes to risk. So none of the things that he was saying were appealing at all. I knew that we had a talent, we had a curriculum, we had potential, but it still sounded like way too much risk compared to the stuff that I was doing. In the end, I decided to plunge myself entirely into the business, and things went bad. Like, things went south in the first year of our operations, because the first year was kind of okay. Like, his dream of making 10K, we're close to that, we're paying our tuition, things were great. And then in 2017, at the beginning of my honors, things started off very, very badly. And at that point, I'm still teetering between entrepreneurship, and there's still kind of a chance that I can pursue a full-time job. I was like 8 days away from getting kicked out of Vince University because I owed them 80,000 Rand. I was basically homeless at the time because I couldn't afford to go to Alberton in the south where my mom is because that's too expensive. So I had to live at my friend's place in Res. And I basically slept on the floor on like one of those hard industrial carpets that leaves marks on your face. And during that whole period, I just kept questioning myself, like, well, was this the right decision? But what I realized was my whole life, it's like when you meet the devil, it's like your whole life has been telling you you're going to end up hungry, not going home, sleeping on an industrial carpet that's going to leave marks on your face. And when you're actually experiencing that, you're like, if this is the worst that can happen, right? That's like a sort of a fork in the road moment where you're like, if this is the worst that can happen, I never want to experience something like this again, so let me choose comfort zone. Or if this is the worst that can happen, and I'm still alive, then let me carry on pursuing this business thing. And if I ever come back to this space, at least I know I won't die, because I didn't die. And 3 years down the line, I'm really glad that I made that decision. But coming out of that entrepreneurial trust was incredibly difficult as a risk-averse person. But yeah, I'm glad my partner had the vision to want to make something of this.
I have questions on that. I'll allow the other two to share their thoughts. Okay, so as far as my moment where I overcame fear and, you know, joined the entrepreneurial space is, and just as a disclaimer, I'm going to make this clarification. Typically, in our minds, we tether entrepreneurship to founding or starting an entrepreneurial venture. And for the longest time, I was incredibly uncomfortable referring to myself as an entrepreneur or even being in spaces where I would be asked to reflect and speak on the thing. And it took a lot of reflection to understand that, like, the scope of my work includes being an enterprising person, as well as being part of a core team that does, you know, impactful work. So mine was overcoming fear as far as what it means to place a bet on a startup and what it means to become a part of something that you didn't necessarily start yourself, but whose vision you're incredibly motivated by. And I went through a phase where I was incredibly, and I say this in the most humble way possible, incredibly bored by, like, my course content. Because I was a debater, most of the things that I was learning in the lecture room, I was already reading up on independently, either because I needed to prepare amazing debate cases or because there were things that I genuinely cared about as far as my political convictions and all of that. And so it got to a point where I was incredibly anxious and sad about, am I constantly going to feel uninspired and anxious and not really committed to school? And this weird thing started happening where I started treating university as like a side project as opposed to the reason I was enjoying it in the first place. And I noticed that I felt like my talents were being used the most, and I felt most challenged and most stimulated when I was doing work with them. And it went from working with them on a project-by-project basis to joining full-time, so having to tell my mother that, like, I want to work in a startup because this is the work that I think is meaningful. And my fear was, I think, primarily located in being uninspired, but also in wasted potential. And I think there was a moment where I realized that, you know that in society, there's almost a role that people assign to you. So you look like you would typically do this. And a lot of people around me, friends included, seemed to assume that I was gonna go into academia and be an academic. And I couldn't think of anything worse than not engaging the world on a day-to-day basis. So having all of this amazing knowledge, but not applying it. Having all of this amazing knowledge, but not having to test it in relation to real human beings and real problems. And I think, understanding that, like, any fears you have around stability, any fears you have around status, around how you're going to be perceived, are nothing compared to the fear of not using your potential, especially when you're young, especially when it's cute to do unconventional things and to explore, because it's never going to be as appealing as it is right now, right? This is the best time to really tap into what your potential could look like. And so that for me was the first engagement with fear, just realizing that, like, any worries I have about the space are nothing compared to what I'll feel and what I'll experience if I wake up one day realizing I played it safe and I missed out on the opportunity to use my talents and really, really challenge myself by working in something new.
Okay, so yeah, these guys really put me under pressure. But for me, I think it's like, even for example, just to give you context, I was invited by my dear friend, your old god friend, god brother. So we've necessarily known each other for like 22 years, but the whole sense of like fear, I think just comes with the mere fact of trying things where you know that you're not going to feel comfortable. And for me, I can tell you, I've tried a variety of things. Be it as like multiple martial arts, or be it as like dance classes, be it as a variety of things that just get me to do something different. So I like to be in spaces where people don't really know me. It gets me to actually try something out and actually engage with that environment. So even though virtual reality, I knew nothing. As in, the only thing I knew was like, what, the Google Cardboard? So that was primarily it. And I think the worst thing that could actually happen to me is that I needed to find a job to to be quite frank. So again, is that I think I was a bit lucky being able to have actually studied abroad. But I think the encouragement was also, again, being when I quit and guys were willing to actually up my salary, I was like, okay, clearly it seems like I actually do have a chance of making things succeed in one form or another. So I think that's just the long and short of it. Nothing all rosy like what these guys have here, but that's primarily my story when it comes to here.
So thank you for that. You guys have a very different perspectives. So I'm going to start with you, Mitchell. My first question to you is, you know, with the story that you shared about the journey and how you got into entrepreneurship and how adverse you were, what was it in your relationship with your best friend and co-founder that carried you through sleeping on the ground and it's basically all gone down the tubes? And how was that relationship? What was the conversations? What were the things that gave you comfort? How did you overcome those fears?
So the first moment where I snapped was obviously the one where my face was bouncing on the floor. But I think I respected how much he put on the line as well, because our university journeys ended up being extremely, extremely different. So I went on and did and finished my honors. And then he ended up not doing postgrad, for example, because entrepreneurship meant that much for him. And that was always a driving factor in my journey of entrepreneurship, just being inspired by the person that I work with every day and looking at the things that they sacrifice. In fact, because I have two partners, and both of them put everything on the line. Both of them left university towards the end, like the last mile, all of it for entrepreneurship. So being surrounded by people like that was really, really inspirational. And again, it goes back to, you know, like, what's the worst that could happen? All these fears that you have about the worst thing that could happen ends up being not that bad. So then, for example, by finishing university and then starting a business that thrives and takes care of them and their families is inspirational. Me ending up at my friend's place, but then working towards a business that 3 months down the line will pay for things is quite inspirational. And it's not just my business partners, but it's sort of my tribe, right? It's the same thing with Dalis. I remember when he came back in 2017, our business was kind of stable, but I was still a bit risk averse, right? So despite all of those things, like, the Virgo in me was like, yo, gotta be conservative and risk averse. But he came back to South Africa, and I was also wondering what this guy's gonna do. I knew that he was super smart, I knew that he was talented and that he knew computers. And within a year, our coffee dates went from him asking, do you know any startup spaces, to him educating me about the startup space because he plunged himself into it. So I really think that tribes are very, very important. My partners were the first members of that tribe, and I've tried to expand it as much as possible. And to this day, when I reflect on my own entrepreneurial journey, this isn't to say I look down on myself for being the person that I am naturally, although I've broken out of that mold finally. But I when I look back at my own entrepreneurial journey, I'm glad that those examples were there. I really, really am. Because if I'd chosen a different route, I would have been surrounded by people who enabled my fears and shared the same fears and shared the same aversions. And I don't think that would have been helpful at all. So yeah, I think tribes are important. To start with your partners, your close friends.
It's all about who you have around you.
Yeah.
So if you know, my question to you is, so with me, so Vilo works at the Hub, so I get to engage with them quite a bit, right? And she's so self-aware and so liberated. And sometimes reminds me a little bit of myself, if I'm being very like, but what I wanted to know, because you mentioned it briefly, you know, how to tell your mother that you wanted to be an entrepreneur and work in a startup, well, working in a startup.
Yeah.
So I know you can, as a self-aware person, you can feel very much like, this is what I want to do, and I'm convicted, and I don't want to waste my potential. But what's the reality of facing, you know, the people that are close and dear, and having to tell them, hey, so about this career thing, ain't gonna happen.
So it's really not glamorous when you're having the real conversations. And my mom is a teacher, so the moment you threaten to disrupt learning and education,
you raise alarm bells, because she obviously works in an environment where, beyond seeing the immense benefits that education can unlock for young people, she's also seen what the absence of education can do to people. So for her, her biggest fear was, am I like losing my child? Because you've always been curious, you've always done well at school, you know, you've always got some good marks. When you weren't getting good marks, I thought it's because you were like really into the debating thing, but now you're scaring me when you're saying things like, I'm gonna need to take a break because I really need to focus on work, and I don't like the feeling of feeling guilty as though I'm like neglecting school. I'd rather put things on pause and focus on rising to this occasion. And you know, there's obviously that worry, but I think what helped was just being honest about the reality of being a young person and engaging institutions of learning. So what I said to my mom was, if you really think about it at the core of it, all we're doing is placing bets, right? So the high school you go to is a bet that when you finish your trip, you're gonna have enough of a quality education that your APS is gonna get you to a good university. When you go to a certain university, you're placing a bet that the institutional merit, as well as the quality of teaching and learning at that institution, is sufficient to not only give you a good qualification, but enough credibility that you're gonna be employable, right? So it's just another bet. And then wherever you go to work at, you're also placing a bet that this job is gonna sustain me, but moreover, this job is gonna bring me fulfillment, status, whatever it is that you prioritize. And I said to my mother, I just wanna place my bets differently. I wanna place my bets on social impact. I wanna place my bets on youth empowerment. I wanna place my bets on young black people who are like myself. Because, you know, if I'm gonna brand myself as a feminist, as an intersectional feminist, as somebody who believes in black consciousness, then I should believe that my brain, which could get me into any major company, is worth aligning with the work done by impactful young black people. And when you explain it that way, suddenly people are understanding. You see, what does it mean if your talent is good enough for bank A or for consulting firm B, but not good enough for the spaces you claim to care about? So she understood it that way. But I also explained to her that, like, look, I can always find a job at the end. Like, again, the worst thing that can happen is that I fail at it and then I get my cushy job and you're happy because I'm earning a stable salary and blah, blah, blah. So there's always, like, the worst case scenario isn't that bad. And it's important to demystify and to help people understand that you're also taking risks when you travel the most common road. You're risking things like actualization sometimes if you're gonna go into spaces where you know that maybe this doesn't really align with what I'm trying to do in the world, but you play it safe. That in and of itself is a risk. So I think being able to explain it that way to my mother, that like I'm not rebelling against institutions of learning, it's just I also think that institutions of learning can sometimes become these silos where, you know, we're all intellectuals writing journals, we're so smart, but we're disconnected from how much the world needs us and from how much our impact could be made. And I think for me, engaging the entrepreneurial space, but specifically in education, means that when I go back to do my honors, even the thesis I'm writing, the sort of research I'm doing, is so much more focused, so much more grounded, and it's about my input in relation to the world, and not necessarily, because at the time I wasn't ready to just write in the abstract, you know, so it's all part of a bigger picture, and if the bigger picture is excellence and impact, then it should be okay.
Okay, so Daddy, so it's probably the most practical person I've met. I met him yesterday, and he's here. He does, you know, we're all talking about emotions and our beliefs. This is just like, the problem is. The solution is this. Which is interesting, you know. Not everybody needs to be passionate and emotional all the time. So my question that I kept asking myself about you is, you're so grounded and practical, but currently in this phase of your life, what's your biggest fear?
it's a bit of like a cliche. It's failure. I think the mere fact that now I've got, it's not the weight of the world on my shoulders, but the mere fact that I went on a bit of a fearless journey of hiring a few people to work with me, and the whole idea is that I was looking at improving the economy. So I think it's just that mere fact of, have I actually contributed in the end to society? And have I actually been able to provide what society expects of me? So the whole thing is that I think I've, in a sense, been blessed. blessed in a variety of ways. And to me, I find that with what I've actually been given, how can I actually spread those learnings to a whole lot of other people as well? So for myself, as in the guys who work with me, I tell them, like, hey, you can come for me, guys. Because it's a choice. I already have the contacts. I already know this guy for 22 years. So the main advice, like, for me, I'm always in that space. So like when he mentions the whole thing of what exactly is happening in the startup space or whatever, that's literally what even happened to me when I was actually in Malaysia. As in, I knew nobody. I knew nothing about what exactly was actually happening there. But I got myself to actually really maneuver around in one from another. So when it comes to the whole question of that fear, I think it's just that case of, if I don't try it, what would be the consequence? And I think it's just that case of probability. The loss, the worst thing that could actually happen, either that I get no response or it's a no. So yeah.
So that's really
been
one, like, recurring theme all three of you, is even though you've gone on the scary thing, what was more scary was not to have applied yourself and not gone on the journey and have life be constantly ask yourself, like, oh, if I had not done it, you know, where would I be if I had done it? So we live in a very complex society, spicy as hell and hot, but how do you think we can create spaces for entrepreneurs that have, so that they're less fearful? Because as a community manager, I hear it a lot, like fear is quite crippling, to the point where people not just fear their thinking, but fear their abilities, fear financial challenges. There's so many different fears that entrepreneurs constantly have to be battling with. So taking into context the realities that we live in, how do you think, if they are, if they're not, they're not.
I think so. I'll speak from my perspective as like somebody who discovered entrepreneurship through working in a startup. I think one of the ways that people can learn to overcome fear is just being in these spaces. I think even if you're not going to start a business yourself tomorrow, if there's a startup, just any entrepreneurial venture doing meaningful work that you buy into, work in that space. Because part of how you demystify your fear is seeing other people do it and then connecting with the entrepreneurial grit within yourself. How you discover that potential and how you discover your own capacity is by learning. And the thing about working with startups is it allows you to gain access to the reality, but from a point of being privileged, because you're not at risk in the same way that like somebody who's a founder, for example, is. And that can allow you, if you're a bit more fearful or you're a bit more ambivalent, to kind of build up the practical context so that one day when it's time for you to start what you want to start, you've gotten the know-how and you've been existing in the space long enough for it to be practical. So I definitely say, if you're not going to start something, create a space by entering the startup, by entering an entrepreneurial venture and contributing to that to see practically how it works.
Just creating rooms for failure, I think that's just the part that I think quite a lot of people don't have the privilege of actually having, where you've just got that room to make a mistake, screw up, and you're forgiven and actually just learn along the way. Because I think when you look at other societies where at least they've got the cash, has been given like $1 million just to see as to if they can actually make something succeed or, for example, if they would actually fail. Yeah, we have to be a bit more conservative because people are, I think, a bit more risk averse. But I think within that space, you also play around with being a bit more creative. But I think that's what I also try to do in my organization, is give people the room to actually fail. If you've got that room to fail, it allows you to actually explore different ventures within the space that you're actually given. So at least you don't have that conscience on your back saying that if I do this, then I'm going to be punished again. Even though, for example, when you're growing up, you always made mistakes. When you're trying to walk, you always made those mistakes. And there was just that room to make sure that, hey, you fail, but eventually you actually succeed.
Yeah. And I think, as friends of entrepreneurs, one of the most practical things we can do is try to create that safe space ourselves. So, for example, with my journey, I think in 2016 and 2017, if it wasn't for the friend who let me crash at his apartment without, I'm not saying don't ask people where they're going to be, because I do that. I hate living, I never live with someone, I mean, until I have to one day, like for now. creating that space where you're not like, hey, dude, when are you leaving? Or, when are you going to get this in order? When are you going to get that in order? I think creating a space where entrepreneurs feel like they can be vulnerable with you because the journey is very hard is important. So you as an entrepreneur, if you have entrepreneur friends as well, please try to create that safe space for them where they don't have to over-explain themselves about the struggles that they're going through. Going back to my early years as well, I think the friends that made it difficult were the ones who would invite me to go out with them, and then when I try to explain that I can't afford to do it, they kind of make it hard for you. Like, what? It's month end though. It's like month end to you means something different. I'm waiting for an invoice that's 60 days late. I can't go out with you. And if it wasn't for the friends who were like, it's fine, I'll come with you, right? Or you can crash at my place. I'll drive you to this thing. I'll give you money for printing. I'll give you my laptop. I literally had to borrow my laptop. All our laptops were stolen the night before our biggest pitch with Acer 2017 with all of our files. And one of our friends just came through for us and gave us their laptop so we could present to Acer so that they could expand our project for a second year. And so I really think, like, guys, let them be vulnerable. I think you yourself as an entrepreneur would want people like that, but you also have the responsibility to let other people be vulnerable, whether it's through their finances, their insecurities, and all of those things. Like, the importance of letting people be vulnerable, I think, is more important than good advice. It's more important than telling them, save money. Allow them to cry, be hungry in front of you, to decline invitations is really, really important. your finances, your legal stuff, and your curriculum development. So I think take a tear a page out of the Alan Gray handbook and just be sensitive to the people that you're dealing with. But don't give them spreadsheet checkers for it. Just do not do that.
But what would be the next? Because obviously they have their objectives that they need to achieve, right? And it's always, for them, it always crunches down to, you know, impact vision, it means this and that. So how do you, what's the middle ground?
The middle, I don't know.
Okay, it's important to listen to the kids. You have to take into account the lived experience of entrepreneurs to get insight into how you can recalibrate even your data capture and how you produce data. I think entrepreneurs can give you very interesting insights into the sort of data sets that they prioritize at that stage. And you always do better by just engaging the end user. And so literally forming consulting panels where you just ask entrepreneurs, to what extent was this aspect empowering? In what ways do you feel you could better measure this aspect? In what ways do you think this data capturing interfered with your ability to be an active entrepreneur and instead locked you into bureaucracy, right? So it's, you have to just listen and gain insights and opinions from the people who actually live that out.
Yeah, on my side, like I mentioned before, room for this, for you to actually fail. As an example, they get you like seed capital, like 200,000, you lose it, then it's a risk. And I think it actually encourages people to actually go out there and try something on their own. As in, we're not a part of any incubator of any sorts. As in, I think it's only what the Innovation Hub, but it's really a case of the reason why we even got into the Innovation Hub is this. If you guys know, we're actually located on a farm. So there's like literally what, vegetables and chickens. So you're not gonna get that much engagement when it comes to talking to people. So with the Innovation Hub, the original was just a case of getting into the network so at least you could actually be engaged with the events in one form or another. And I think they have actually helped because again, our business also focuses highly on like the likes of import, export. So again, is that they generally just like send out free invites. So the only issue I think for quite a lot of people might be access to these venues. So like for example, the Innovation Hub is all the way in Victoria.
Yeah,
so it's quite far for quite a lot of people. So again, is that I do know that there's a small phone as well. I also just go there for a few events. But I think if you just don't have the resources, it does become a bit of a drain to travel from one place to another. And just thinking about like right now with the way that the world is moving, I think even like with this whole coronavirus scare, it's like the biggest work from home experience. You'd end up thinking that obviously things like video conferencing and even like virtual reality, I'm plugging myself again, can actually be used to actually get people to engage and learn in different ways rather than actually having to all congregate in one particular area.
Okay, do you guys have any other box that you want to have before I open it to the floor? No?
Yeah,
it is. Okay, so guys, we're opening it up to you guys. You can ask questions, but like I asked before, stand up, you say your name, your passion, and you can ask questions. Are you ready? Not all together at once now. One by one. Okay, there we go. Thank you. God, you killed that openness.
Hero. Hi everyone. So my name is Rama, and I'm a freelance researcher, particularly in the social development space. So my question is more around like the mental health side of things. So firstly, how big is it? And then what are your mental health things?
Everyone looked at me because I just... You know what happened last November? No, it wasn't quite. But anyway, I think from a mental health point of view, like last year, I think around October, November, I had an anxiety attack, right? And I've always known throughout my life that I had anxiety, but to varying degrees. And When I experienced that in November, the reason why it was a shock is that previously when I experienced anxiety, it was never a visceral thing, like, I think I'm gonna die now. It was always more of a, like a, I don't know, just your stomach knots up and all of those things. What last year November taught me though is that I wasn't taking care of myself as much as I thought I was, because physically I was exercising, I was eating decently, but I wasn't compartmentalizing my work and life balance as well as I thought I was. And as a result, when work things started getting lit, so last year one of our clients, his invoice was really, really late. And at that point, we just ran a project where we hired 10 staff members. We had bills to pay. We just redone our website. And all of these things are compounding on me. Crises that are normal in most businesses, but what I learned last year in November is that I've never really practiced or learned how to deal with crises like that. And I think what my brain and my body were telling me last year in November is that it's been 3 years, it's enough now, right? Either see someone or talk to someone, but going forward, it's only going to get worse. And if you don't start taking care of your mental health now, in a few years' time, it's not going to be 8 staff members and a couple of 100,000. It's going to be 5,000 staff members and millions of rand. And what's going to happen there, right? So I really think that from a mental health point of view, like, guys, please start taking care of it from day one and don't wait till things get bad. And when I say take care of it, I don't mean if you can't afford a therapist, that's totally fine. But find your thing and stick to it as a routine. Like, if it's once a week, you know, having lunch with your mother or that one aunt who really gets you or that one mentor, just having that routine outlet. But please do not leave it to chance. Don't leave it to when I have time, I'll reach out to Aunt Spanban. Or my, please make it a routine so that every time these problems happen, you can nip them in the bud and not wait until 3 years has passed and your brain is like, enough. And now I'm going to paralyze your body because that's, it gets there. So yeah. Mental health, day one.
Yeah. What Mwani said about, you know, in the context of not affording therapy, I think that's also important because the realities of that country are such that comprehensive care for your mental well-being is very, very inaccessible. And one of the things that you can do if you're not in a position to afford therapy for your depression, your anxiety, your bipolar, whatever it may be that you're dealing with, is that you've got to be quite meticulous in picking up your triggers. So I know when I was in varsity, specifically second year, was a really, really tough time because I felt such a deep sense of sadness. And one of the things that I noticed was how my sadness was linked to existential questions around my purpose. So I was at my saddest when I felt like I'm not in greater alignment with where I should be going. So there's, you know, you can be an anxious person, but that can be triggered by things like, what is my purpose? Or I'm not happy with what I'm doing at school. So at a point where you don't have the privilege of having a professional to help you create those systems, you've got to take it seriously. So like journaling is also very important, documenting how you feel. So you can pick up on days when you can't get out of bed, what is happening around you, on days where everything feels like it's collapsing, but you still find happy spaces. Is it that you're showing up and doing this amazing project at work? Is it that you love debating? Is it that you that working with high schoolers leaves you inspired, for example? So in the absence of being able to afford, note what your triggers are, note what makes things better also. And it helps you understand your mind and the space you're in, but it can also help you gain understanding about bigger questions, like the sort of person you are, what works for you, what doesn't work for you. So just document, 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 especially if you don't have the privilege of professional help at the time.
Okay, so...
just a practical thing.
Yeah, I suppose so. My routine, when it comes to like mental health, I try as much as possible to just get myself out of the space. So sometimes it might be like at work, at least I've actually got this option, and I actually leave that option for the rest of the guys who work in the office. It's like, hey, if you're in a bad mood, just don't come to the office. Yeah. If anything, fine, you can actually work away from home or whatever, but just do things which at least get you into a good mood. So for me, I think it's what, hitting the gym, be there in the morning or be there in the evening. Apart from that, it would be like on a weekend, I'll probably just be reading a book. I might actually just even go to the office. As in, yeah, office, you wouldn't necessarily think that it's relaxing, but for me, it's like, hey, sometimes that's the best time that I can actually work on the things that I wasn't able to do during the week. So I think, again, the whole thing of people. That's why I suppose I work in coffee shops, because you always meet interesting people in a coffee shop. As in, that's always just been my case. Quite some time, even my first sales came from a coffee shop, and you know, you're doing interesting things. People always just like wonder what exactly you're doing and not being engaged with that. So I think it's just keeping my mind active, and then I think lastly, humor. As in, humor is the one thing that actually just keeps me sane. As in, that's why, for instance, even think Twitter, people say it's toxic. I just make sure that I'm putting the right amount of thinking. So yeah.
Good point. Yeah.
Okay, we have another question
from Kara. Well, actually, it's like six questions.
Okay. Wow. Yes. Are you for it?
So, my name is Mike. I care quite if that's too much of a time to speak before we might be in school. I want to start with one thing, and everyone's going to get a question, so I'm going to. You spoke about, I have two questions. For the Ellen Gray Owens Foundation, you spoke about the criteria that is needed to qualify for funding. What is that criteria?
So there's different entry points. So one is the scholarship, which is a high school program. So you enter, you apply on grade 6, and it's from grade 8 to grade 12. And then there's the tertiary program, which you enter from like grade 12. But the criteria is it is academically focused, but you also look for potential for entrepreneurship. So it's entrepreneurial potential. There's an application form that you fill out, that you answer various questions. Through those questions, you're able to assess whether you meet that criteria.
You also spoke about a growth mindset. What does that mean?
I love that.
So growth mindset is that ability to literally be able to expand your thinking and not literally be fixed on one thing when you're working on an idea. Mm-hmm. So you're flexible around how you do things. Yeah, be very much open to expand your thinking around how you do things.
Okay.
Cool. In a nutshell.
Sorry, it's Sinclair, right?
Yes,
they asked a question around fear, right? And I was asking myself, well, is fear a bad thing? Why are we attributing such a connotation to that word? Because I think if you think about it in a different way, right?
Yeah.
From the perspective of saying, there's a fear that I'm going to fail in this thing that I'm trying to start. Versus the fear that I'm going to become a no-name brand person who's doing the same exact thing that other people are doing. Why are we attributing such a connotation to the word fear? Should it be something that you take away? Or should it be something that you say, listen, there's a fear of this thing, you just have to push through it?
So I think, you know, fear is not a negative thing. I personally find fear to be a catalyst.
Okay.
For me, if I'm scared, innately I know this is somewhere that I need to grow. Mm-hmm. Because my mind is telling me that I don't have the skills or I don't have the ability to be able to follow through on this, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I also understand that my processing and understanding of fear is not everybody else's, right? Because that's a little bit more, you know, and not everybody's like that. So I think I've placed the conversation to accommodate more the person who is crippled by fear. Because what we want to do is encourage that person. The person who's not crippled by fear is going to do it anyway, to be honest. The person who's accelerated and catalyzed by fear is probably doing it already. But if fear has that numbing or debilitating effect on you, then let's talk about it. Let's normalize this. Let's unpack it, put light on it, and see what is it that you're really, really scared about.
Yeah.
And that's really what we were trying to do here. It wasn't to say like, oh, fear so like it. No. What we want to do is like, we want to break people's shackles and free people in as much as we can in as real a way as possible.
Okay.
Yeah?
Cool. Thanks. Well, man. Sorry, I apologize. I'm not great with names. That's just a practical question, right? Sorry, what's the name of your company again?
Timu. Yes.
Access to these educational facilities in rural areas.
Yeah.
Because I come from the Eastern Cape.
Yeah.
And my cousin, technically, she's a teacher.
Yeah.
And when you go speak to these kids, right, they have no clue about what Timu is trying to do, what the NYDA is trying to do. Access to information is the biggest barrier to starting these things and to letting people know, okay, this is possible, here's where you can go get the information. Are you guys reaching out to those different places?
Yeah. So
So what we've been very, very big on that from day one. Like I said, we wanted to close the bridge. And I'm going to give you a little anecdote on how we did it. We started doing it last year. So Axel, who is our biggest client, biggest partner, probably our favorite as well, but anyway, so Axel, who's an amazing partner, has always wanted to expand our programs not only across South Africa, but across Africa to make sure that every single child has access to it. So last year, we expanded our program nationwide for the first time. And so I lived in Mpumalanga for 5 years in my life. I was born in Limpopo, then I lived with my grandmother in Mpumalanga. And I've always noted that in Mpumalanga, there's no industry for after-school activities or extracurriculars at all. So when we were recruiting schools last year, the most troublesome province was Mpumalanga. Because it's a largely rural province. And so I remember last year we literally got like a cab driver in Nelspruit to drive us around this rural area in a point where the roads were so narrow, we had to start literally walking to make sure that we could get to schools that otherwise wouldn't know about our program. So that is an example of how every partner, every member of the team really wants to get this work out to as many people as possible. Obviously, our limitations are what the budget is for that particular year. So in 2017, we couldn't do it. 2018, we could do it in Gauteng by moving to the violent stuff. Last year, we could do it in Mpumalanga as well as the Northern Cape and the Northwest. But one of the things that we're going to be introducing this year as part of our academy program is doing online learning, where we're able to reach rural schools by doing video conferencing lessons. Because in some instances, we're not able to get tutors out to every single one of those rural schools. But if you're able to get them the equipment, which is very basic, sometimes it's a computer and a modem, and that's it. If you're able to get those type of tools out to rural schools, then every single one of them can take part in an academy lesson that 5 years ago, only kids from St. John's could do. So we're always trying to innovate and use technology, leverage technology to make sure that if I'd stayed in Mpumalanga after the year 2000, I would have ended up being one of those kids. And at the least, I would have wanted to move to put a laptop in my teacher's class so I can take part in things like this. So those are some of the things that we'll be doing as of this year.
We'll follow up. Is this going to be in the 12 official languages? Is that something you'd like to go for?
I think we did consider that once upon a time, but it's incredibly difficult because the type of programs that we create are also pan-African in nature. So trying to get everyone to speak and sort of communicate and participate in the same language is of the utmost importance. You know, unfortunately, colonialism, so English is that language. But in our drive to be a pan-African organization, we need to get everyone to be able to communicate in the same language. And that's what happens to English.
Yeah, so I say 12, because the 12th one is sign language. I know they don't come to English.
Yeah.
In relation to shit.
Yeah.
So, English is Bilo. Conceptualizing as citizens in South Africa.
Yeah.
Right. What does that mean? And allow me to frame the question in this way. If you ask anybody around the world that who's a Nigerian, right, they can point to a singular identity. Right? They look the same way, they dress the same, or not same, but similar. You can point to that guy. If you ask them about a Kenyan guy, you can also get the same sort of. Ask them about someone from Rwanda, they all Rwandanese, there's no separation. In South Africa, there's a whole fractured kind of thinking to say, that's nonsense. But in any case, how do you then overcome that to conceptualize and say, we as SA citizens, what is SA, what is South Africa?
I think it's a very important question because, as you've said, our national consciousness is usually denigrated by tribalism. But one of the things, and I guess other African nations that have consolidated some form of national identity have also had to contend with these issues. One of the most important things to do is to connect with your national history and to connect with the sort of problems and responses that your society needs. So in South Africa, for example, it's really important to always connect to the fact that you peacefully
transition into a democratic state as peacefully as possible at the time. So things like that, that like we're capable when needed, right, to rise to the occasion and contribute our intellectual talents, our political consciousness, our capacity to organize, our ability to teach, our ability to be doctors in our communities to work towards a wider goal of liberation. It's been done before. And I think the what we try to do at Zimun through our programs, through not only you know teaching these competencies and debating, but having even topics that allow kids to connect to the wider conundrum that South Africa is facing, or rather the set of conundrums, is that we always try to make kids understand that they're citizens, they need to be empowered citizens, and they need to be solution finders. And if you can get a young mind to buy into the idea that they're special and that they've got solutions to contribute, that can transcend any ngumZulu, ngumXhosa, any tribalism, because even part of rising to the occasion and finding those solutions is finding solutions even to the things that fracture us identity-wise. So it's what we try to do. And a good way of building that active citizenship and connecting to a national identity is also when people are sharing ideas, your identities matter less. I mean, they matter, right? But when your identities are not a weapon and are instead an arena that is like where certain understandings and worldviews are built, and you're sharing those ideas with other people who come from different arenas, then they're empowering and they contribute towards a wider consciousness. So I think it's that, is that turn people into thinkers and solution finders, and they'll leave behind all of the problematic associations that they make with themselves.
You spoke about you need to create a space for failure.
Yeah.
Right. So let me use an example. Facebook was allowed to fail. Was
yeah.
Not cash positive.
True.
In 7 years.
Yeah.
But they were not allowed. They didn't have to get to that point. Right? We live in a far different reality. Right? We have to turn around and fairly quickly within a year or two. How do we create that space?
My thoughts have been that you have to look for those people. It's a very hard journey. And that's why, for example, I think, like with anything in life, it's like a business. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it. It's as simple as that. So for instance, even when you talk of this whole room of failure or whatever, like on Twitter, I follow quite a lot of guys in the US as well, where there was one guy who said, if you are turning over 5,000 to 50,000, send an email and see as to where things go. So I think you're trying to look for those people who can actually allow for that encouragement for you to actually play around. So for example, I think, yeah, we live in a reality where, the variety of factors, so for example, your livelihood. Maybe you've got family and even relatives or even probably even friends that you have to take support of. So it's gonna be a very slow process where it's that building of their ecosystem. It was like even for myself, when I'm looking at the long term, I've run a business. If I've been able to run a business, then I can actually give that capital for other people to also run and fail at their businesses as well. But it requires a huge amount of effort. And again, I think even when it comes to regulation as well, is to actually see that there is that play with the government where they can also understand as to where exactly we're coming from. But it's not going to be an easy job. That's all I can just say. Is that, for instance, even like with the AR, VR, a hackathon, Africa hackathon that we're going to have, is that we've got guys in Mozambique who don't even have access to the tools that we even have here. I've got guys in the office where I'm like, I can send those guys down to Mozambique if the opportunity opens itself, so they can actually spread that knowledge. Because again, is that it's the whole thing of working in your local environment in order for that to actually spread. Because the top-down approach, unfortunately, so I've seen it numerous times, it does not necessarily work that well. You literally have to work within that small confine and then grow the pie that you've actually got in order for other people to actually get a piece of it. So yeah, that's pretty much my take. As in, I can't see it as being anything easy, but it's just really trying to get, like for instance, you even having this conversation right now.
Yeah.
If we were to connect or whatever, I tell you on a regular basis, if I've got those contacts, that way you'd be like, hey, there's this person, hey, there's that person. You're the one who also needs to go out and actually contribute. Because again, I think in that giving spirit, more is actually given along the way.
Yeah.
But it just takes time, as an initiative. It is just a time-taking initiative.
Okay, cool. Last question, maybe. There's a private, I know that a lot of people want to ask that question. what can government do to assist them? That is not the case of that moment. What can the Ellen Gray Holders Foundation or private companies as a whole do to get us closer to the place where there is space for faith?
So I think I'll answer for Impact Hub. And then one girl answer for Ellen Gray.
Yeah.
I think for spaces like Impact Hub, it's creating these platforms. It's us going out, we have to copy what you say. I want to create a space where, yes, your fellows need to learn, but also we open the door for other people who aren't fellows to come in, and they get exposure to what you do, they also get the content and learn while they're in the space. I think also we need to think broader than just finance, you know, as if it's the only resource. It's not. You get networks, you get social capital, you get knowledge, you get innovation. They are just as, if not more, important than finance. But we have to change our mindsets. We need to expose ourselves to more of these type of conversations. And then we start seeing opportunities. And then we can really take advantage of them. So for me, these spaces are very important. This moment where you ask this question, we answer, and someone else will say, I also think, and we can also do it this way. It's important.
No, I agree. Also in terms of just even mentorship as well.
Yeah.
There's a lot of structures around this mentorship, coaching, all of the structures that we also provide for our participants on our program. So those are various things that I think are very important for individuals that are part of this journey.
So there's barriers to entry to those things, isn't it? In the sense that there isn't necessarily a culture of mentorship. Like, when I come from Israeli child, when I'm done and I've succeeded, I don't go back to Israeli child to tell to the market when I want to hear from you. There's none of that practically
Which is what you picked up. You say you don't do that. Which is something that now it's on you to say, I need to do it. Right? So it starts with you, ultimately. So you need to take the first step in order to be able to encourage others to actually go. So it's easy to say there's nothing, there's no culture, but you as an individual also need to take that first step.
Right.
Yeah.
Be the challenge.
Awesome.
Thank you so much for your time and questions. The fact that you made notes, I'm low-key inside like, oh man, this was so thanks for that. We have another question here from our lovely lady.
I have three.
Okay, it's all right. We've got time. Take your time for your questions.
Okay. So my name is Letha. I'm passionate about sharing knowledge, which is why I'm in the publishing space. Currently sort of in the sales sort of section of the publishing space, but I am trying to get out of the closet and eventually publish my own stuff. Okay, so my previous so I am confused a bit because there's a bit of a misconception around what social is. I always thought it was NGOs and NPOs.
No. No, make money.
Oh, we make money. Okay. So even when like on that form they were like, are you into social entrepreneurship? I'm like, no, I'm not into social no. So my question was basically, what is social entrepreneurship?
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, do you want me to answer or do you want one of
the panelists? Yes, anyone.
Should
I answer or
should you? I can answer.
You know what, you answered,
yeah,
a little bit about
UA
for a second.
Okay, so that's a very good question, because when we started out, I remember one of the reasons I didn't want to enter entrepreneurship was because of the perception of the work that we do. Like, we thought very highly of ourselves as a 21st century educational company, but everyone that we engaged with saw us as an NGO, right? And that's fine, because there are a lot of NGOs that do amazing work, and some who funded some of our work, but that's not how we wanted to position ourselves at all. We always wanted to be a social enterprise. And we came up with our own internal sort of benchmarking system, where most companies are driven by profit, and that's it. And that's called the bottom line. And then you get the triple bottom line, which is profit, people, planet, and all of that stuff. So we took it very, very seriously, to add the social profit element of benchmarking our performance into our company culture. So for example, doing like, I think what sets social enterprise apart from other enterprises is that if I was selling pots, I'd come into a town, open up a store, sell pots, that's cool. If I was selling cars, I'd come into a town, sell cars, whatever. I think what a good social enterprise does is understand the assets of a community that they're going to work with before they even intervene, so that the work that they're doing is always informed by social assets and not financial assets. So if I'm going to, when we were working in Gauteng alone, the social assets are pretty easy to understand. We're working with suburban kids, we're working with kids from the township, and that's Gauteng's makeup. What impact do we want to have on kids from the township and kids from the burbs? Now when we expand nationwide, it's Mpumalanga and Limpopo predominantly rural. So what are the social assets there? Our liabilities, right? Schools like this, schools don't have this, blah, 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 blah. So how can we work with the community that they have as things stand to improve education? So I think a good social entrepreneur understands social assets along with financial assets and then looks for financial profits and social profits. And for us, the social profit is that we're going to work with 500 kids. By the end of our program, we need to have improved their five competencies. We need to be able to assess that they truly improved in those competencies. And if of the 500 at the beginning, only 50 were good, and at the end, 450 were good, that's a profit of 400 kids who've been impacted. And I think that's what sets social entrepreneurs apart from other normal greedy entrepreneurs.
Also, the work of social entrepreneurs is often tethered to wider national or global social development goals. So it's work that, for example, if you're an education company, it's very obvious that nationally and at a global level, education and combating things like illiteracy are at the fore of everybody's mind. Another thing would be, for example, if you work in fintech, you could. There's fintech, but then there's also fintech in the context of social entrepreneurship, where maybe you're primarily concerned with integrating rural populations as far as more comprehensive access to financial solutions and those sort of things. And that's tethered to a wider goal of financial literacy, financial independence and all of those things. So it's also beyond everything that Mani said, it's work that's tethered to a much bigger picture as far as advancing social progress. And in being tethered to a bigger picture, it means that the values of a social enterprise also necessarily mean that you cannot harm the very same communities that you operate in, the very same communities that you want to uplift. So there's an ethic and a wider set of strategic development goals that are tied to that.
Okay, thank you. My understanding.
Uh-huh.
Okay, and then my second question is, how do you mirror sort of like, because when you ask us the icebreaker of like what is our passion, how do you mirror a passion that is basically driven by an idea and then identifying sort of a gap in the market that you can enter into? Because I feel like that is currently what I am sort of kind of experiencing. I don't know if maybe it's because my idea is not well developed yet, because I do very much know my passion. I feel very strongly about sharing knowledge. So how do you mirror sort of an idea that you have to identify a gap in the market?
It's like a simple equation. You go out to the market, you give them the product and see if they'll actually give you money for it. So I'm just talking about like past experience, right? When I was in high school, I identified that there weren't a whole lot of people who had graphics cards. And now I'm really just getting very technical with computers or whatever, but it was literally that I was like, guys, can you pay me 50%? I'll figure out the other 50%, and I'll bring the items into South Africa. I was actually importing them from the US. But literally, it's a case of the only way you can actually know if your idea makes sense or not is to actually put it out into the market. Sometimes it's always a question of like timing, like for example, if the iPhone didn't come about, you wouldn't have Uber, it wouldn't make sense for people to be booking on their computers. But sometimes this is the case of you have to put something out there. And the thing is that with ideas, they're cheap. You have to just generate a whole lot of ideas up until something actually sticks. Because maybe as that, for instance, if I thought that my goal in life was always to become a computer scientist, and that's one thing that I actually grew up wanting to be. But the thing is that like right now, virtual reality. I'm not too sure how many people would have predicted like 20 years ago that virtual reality would become a thing that people would actually even study towards. But it's one of those things that, hey, someone came up with an idea, like with virtual reality. Just to give you an idea, is that it came with the modern mobile phone components. Put them together, something worked. Oh, wow, this is something new that we can actually iterate on. And that's where there was this, let's build that idea. But remember, as you have to just generate a whole lot of ideas. My favorite job is actually you with friends, and you know they're facing a problem or whatever, just throw ideas.
Yeah.
Just see if the ideas will actually work. Because the only way that you can actually figure out things is, again, execution is just an idea in itself. That you literally have to execute and figure out ideas on how to actually get your whole idea or even wanting to publish. Because again, like even self-publishing is an easy idea to actually execute. You can really test that. For instance, I've got one friend who's also in my network. He runs the 90 days without sugar movement. So again, as in he literally self-published his book, as in that was an idea in itself, and he was able to build a community that was able to actually spur on that idea. Yeah.
And I think one of the things that we learned when we were doing the eSpec program last year was our mentors and tutors were very, very big on going to market immediately, right? So we last year created this world-class curriculum with contributions from people from Cambridge, the UN, Bain, and like really, really dope people. And we were planning on publishing it into this beautiful masterpiece and then testing it in the market and getting like 1,000 kids around the country to sign up. And we had all these dreams, and one of the things our mentors told us is you don't even know if people like your product. You like it, but is someone willing to pay for it? Is the problem. So they forced us to start doing a number of holiday programs and market experiments, which, you know, in all honesty, were embarrassing, right? For a number of reasons. We spent 3 years working with these really glamorous corporate clients, and everyone sees the work that we're doing. Now Timon's doing a program with 5 kids in a tiny room, and it's like, what happened? Have you fallen from glory? It was us dropping our pride and saying, we created this amazing program. Now we need to test it in the market, and we need to test it with 5 kids, and then expand it to 10, and eventually we'll get to our 5,000. And I think, again, another fear thing that gripped us last year was that pride, right? Everyone knows who we've worked with, what we've done. We're hanging out with basketball players now, business partners, people, now you're running a program for 5 kids, but the reason we're doing that is because we had to drop our pride and say, this product might not be dope, and we need to test out whether or not it's dope. And if it is a great product, then we'll keep expanding it. So I think with whatever dream you have, please do not be blinded by other people's perception of where you are in your career right now, what you're doing. You must be willing to drop your pride and just throw your product out in the market, accept all the criticism that comes your way, tweak the product and make sure it's market ready, and then one day you'll get to your 5,000. But it's not gonna happen overnight. But yeah, I think your heart's and your mind's even in the right place right now. And I think the day you jump into it, your passion's going to take you very, very far. Don't let people convince you that it will. It'll drive you to go very, very far. But just remind yourself that you're willing to embarrass yourself. You're willing to have people question what happened to her. Wasn't she hanging out with this CEO and this manager? And now she's selling publishing services to do it for writing books for video, I don't know, right? But do those things, because they really, really matter. And it's only the market's opinion that matters more than like, the haters.
That one is also a question.
My bad. Okay, and then the last one is actually to do with money. So my question is it a bad thing to want to chase money in entrepreneurship? Like, if you're like, that's my goal, I just want to make money and be my own boss and not answer to anyone. Is that like, because I think what I've sort of noticed is like, and I've also told people this, I'm like, no, don't chase money because, you know, it ends, but your passion doesn't. So I wanted to find out from actual entrepreneurs if that's a thing, if it's a bad thing to chase.
Before I deactivated Twitter 2 weeks ago, I tweeted something. I tweeted something not so long ago saying I find it very hard to in the South African climate to advise people to not chase money, because things are very, very hard in South Africa. Like, you know, like handy hand is really expensive, so is boats and electricity and airtime. So no, I don't think there's anything wrong with chasing money. I think the issue though, and we're living in a wonderful time in history right now where a lot of young people are becoming anti-billionaire and all of those things, right? I love it. Me. But where that movement comes from is the recognition that, like, if you're going to start a company, right, there's nothing wrong with wanting to be wealthy. There's nothing wrong with wanting to change your family circumstances, take care of your kids, travel the world, build the house of your dream, drive the car of your dream. There's nothing wrong with any of those Instagram aspirations, because we all have them. The problem comes in where you start compromising the dignity of your workers to achieve that. If your assistant cannot afford to get to work, if your cleaner cannot afford to pay their child's school fees, Barack Obama described it as like a poverty of ambition, right? You want to own all these things and monopolize all the money that there is in the system, right? But like, you have your house, you have your car, but your workers are being exploited. So I really, really think that in the quest to be wealthy and to build something substantial for yourself, look around you and ask yourself if you're compromising anyone's dignity and if you're paying them fairly for the labor that they are transacting with. Because a lot of billionaires, the reason why we hate billionaires isn't because they're rich necessarily, it's how they became billionaires, it's how they treat the lowest common denominator in their company. It's the fact that Jeff Bezos is the richest man in the world, and that's fine if he wants to be rich, but the people in his warehouse can't even go to the bathroom, right? Can't take bathroom breaks, and that's a serious crisis of ethics. So I think balance your ambition and your ethics and how you take care of people.
So I'm in the design space, so there's a lot of Instagram. So my question is more to the audience. So in terms of fear, so let's say for instance your business, whatever, requires to buy a painting. You're not buying to show off or to whatever, but you just buy a painting. So obviously your friends and even your family, they're gonna see you differently. So in terms of fear, how do you deal with that? Have you experienced that?
Issues because they imagine that you wouldn't be able to do the thing that you said you actually did, and now all of a sudden they wish, I need you to fix my car, I need you to do this.
In a sense, that, well, maybe we're sort of answering the question, but essentially, most of the personalities are basically, do you be comfortable, you know, you have to do it, say you bought a helicopter and you have to buy a helicopter, but then it comes with a certain weight. How you add this at
the my question is, why are you assigning the weight to other people's perception? I don't understand where that.
Okay.
Is your self-worth derived from that? If that's the case, it's a problem, right? Self-esteem is self-weight, it's one month's weight. So you have to think, it comes from within. So you can't say, Jita is driving a Taz, and now that's an issue. That's a reflection of his success. Or someone's back home, or someone's driving a bed. Those things are material, right? It's the substance of what you're bringing to the table. It speaks to what Gorman was saying. It's not about how much money you have. It's, can you look yourself in the mirror and see? Are you cool to say, hey, chief, this is what I'm doing, and this is the impact of what I'm doing? That's right.
Yes, we have one here at the front.
Just quickly, then.
what I'm hearing from your question is, how do you become that person who bought the Bentley but still have to say, no, I can't give you $1,000 for groceries next month because this Bentley is for XYZ, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I need to be perceived a certain person to my partners, but that doesn't mean I actually am that person. Unfortunately, I feel you have to compartmentalize
how other people perceive you. Yeah, I think the trick is compartmentalize, because you've already compartmentalized your own identity versus the identity that you have to be for business. By knowing that you have to buy that value for the sake of your clients so that they trust you with their money, you've compartmentalized things. So you have to use that same system with your family. You have to be able to be like, okay, this flashing light is different from the girl you know what I mean? I'm still yeah.
Excited, probably raving about my son is going to be a lawyer. Okay, and then all of a sudden you embark on this journey of entrepreneurship. But then at the same time, as you embark on this journey of entrepreneurship, media is also blowing you up. Media is blowing you up.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So, on the one end, you're saying, hey, it's hard, I'm hustling, I'm trying to do my thing. On the other end, media is blowing you up and saying, look at all these amazing things that Chimong is doing, you know. So that particular, how do you stay grounded in that context of having to balance out that?
I actually did a weird exercise in December where I compartmentalized my family and like which group of people were the most anti-risk and which ones were just like whatever, right? And at the core was my dad. My dad is as risk averse as I am. In fact, I think I inherited that from him initially. When I left law school, he wasn't happy at all, to be honest. He really, really wasn't happy with that decision. It didn't make sense for him at all. My mother, on the other hand, raised me for 18 years of my life and then became my best friend afterwards. So we've got this weird relationship where she, as much as she allows me to do or allowed me to do whatever it is that I wanted to do, she's always probing about whether or not I'm sure. In fact, even 2 weeks ago, she still asked me, are you sure this entrepreneurship thing is working? I'm like, Mom, I'm paying rent. I'm on my, it's been 4 years now. I'm out of the house. What do you mean, are you sure? So there's varying degrees. And then extended family members are the ones who are like, this guy's on TV? Screw that, no degree. You know, it's like, so they thought I was like this millionaire dude and whatever. So they were very, very supportive. So the hierarchy moves down from like extended family who are just happy to see you being recognized for the work that you do, to my mother, who's very, very supportive and was the one who gave me the 500 grand to register the company and, you know, design our logo and all of that, to someone like my dad who was like, this is a bitter pill to swallow and I refuse to swallow it. Whereas now he's sort of come on board. And I think staying grounded is just like, I don't know, it's am I grounded? I don't know. I think staying grounded is just reminding myself of like where I was. Like, I keep using the being in my friend's best apartment because that really grounds when you're sleeping on the ground, right? It's just reminding myself that, like, you know, there's nothing, sure, we're special, we should value ourselves and so on, but, like, I don't know, it's you're not that special, and you're not an authority in everyone's life, and don't be too excited to give people advice and tell them, oh, this is how I did it, just because they saw you on TV. So for me, it's humbling myself in front of people that the world tells me not to humble myself in front of. When I was living in Mpumalanga, for example, my grandmother was my absolute role model. Now that I've been in Joburg for 20 years, went to this school, have a business and whatever, I still think she has a lot of things to teach me, and I still think there's a lot of value to gain from having conversations with her. Same thing with my dad, same thing with my mother, same thing with that one uncle that no one takes seriously, but like, he sees the vision. So I think just reminding myself that I'm not too special to listen to anyone has been one of the most important things. Yeah, even my 5-year-old nephew, like, teaches me a lot about curiosity.
You have a question? I want to ask a question in response to the helicopter. And I want to ask the question more as a challenge. We all have people around us who exert expectations on us. But whose expectation is it? And where is my responsibility to meet that expectation? Because to me it sounds like that's exactly where your question came from. And then I would turn around and say, when I'm lying with my cheek on the carpet in my mate's dorm room, who's bailing me out? Because if you weren't there, why should I have a responsibility to come back to you? If you were there for me, if it was your carpet that I was lying on, by all means, I've got your back, but and I'm going to you. But if you were there when you were my aunt, when you were my mom, when you were my uncle, or my mate's mate, what expectation, what right do you have to put an expectation on me? Is the question that I would actually ask. And then for those people who are contributing to your skills, who are contributing to your mentorship, who are contributing to all of these things, sometimes I would also ask the question to say, it's not a case of paying it back, it's a case of paying it forward. Who you had to pay it forward to? And somebody who's exerting an expectation on you, or somebody that you have met in a climate like this, who is actually deserving, exhibiting the characteristics and the merits of the skills that you have that you want to invest in and pass those on. So that would be my challenge. Expectation versus merit.
Your thoughts in some way. We have 30 minutes, no, an
so many schools.
Wave to the camera, say goodbye. Thanks for tuning in.
See you next month. Tune in again. Share with your friends. Do the right thing.
Shout out to the sound.